Food security is one of the main challenges in East Africa, where food production is challenged by extreme weather, weather conditions brought by climate change. While trade can be a tool to mitigate food crisis, it is by no means an automatic process. Appropriate synergies need to be built with climate change and food security policies. This session will aim to demonstrate how synergizing trade and climate change at multilateral, regional, national levels can enhance food security and improve livelihoods in the context of the East African Community region. Since 2011, CATS International and its partners in East Africa have been at the forefront of advocating for appropriate synergies across the three policy areas. Under the project, as some of you may be aware, promoting agriculture, climate, trade linkages in East Africa, PACT EAC. Hundreds of East African stakeholders were sensitized, trained, and moved to advocacy action towards the goal. Recent developments go in the right direction and indicate that policy responses are becoming more coherent. These will be discussed by you and by members of the panel who are here with me during this session, as well as their potential implications on food security and livelihood. We shall have presentations, and the titles or title of the presentations will be "What Are the Effects of Incoherent Trade and Climate Policies Regimes on Food Security and Livelihood at Regional and National Levels?" This topic is going to be discussed first by the first speaker, Martha Getachew Bekele. She's a program officer at CATS Africa Resource Center in Nairobi. Martha has been a program officer, trade and development program at CATS Africa Resource Center, Nairobi, since 2013. That's about 2 years. Prior to joining CATS, she worked as the consultant for the World Bank, for which she published research on youth employment and contributed to the first participatory poverty assessment in Ethiopia. She also lectured at the Addis Ababa University, Addis Ababa Commercial College, and Kenya Methodist University. Martha holds a master degree, a Master of Science degree, International Trade Policy and Trade Law from Trade Policy Training Center in Africa, TRAPCA, of Lund University. The next topic which will be discussed by John Mwesige is how synergized climate and trade policies regimes can enhance food security and livelihood. John has 11 years of working experience at policy level. He is currently working at the economic sector as the economic sector specialist at National Capacity Building Secretariat in Rwanda. Before joining NCBS, he worked as trade negotiator for Rwanda and COMESA Desk Liaison Officer. John participated in negotiations of different regional trade agreements and is a founding member of Rwanda National Trade Policy Forum. Then we shall have the next speaker, the third, will speak on the topic how synergized climate and trade policies regimes can enhance food security and livelihoods. That will be Paul Muraje, County Director, Meteorological Service, Muranga County in Kenya. He's working as the County Director of Meteorological Services within the Muranga County Government. Then we have the next topic, next speaker will speak on the topic. Are UNFCCC and WTO regimes acting in synergy to each other and taking account of the food security and livelihood concerns? This topic will be discussed by Jane Nalunga on my right, immediate right. She's a director of CETINI in Uganda. She is the country director of Southern and Eastern African Trade Information and Negotiations Institute, that is CETINI, Uganda. She holds a master's degree from the University of London and is an associate of the Institute of Chartered Secretaries and Administrators. Then the last topic, but it is not least, will be on do climate and trade policies at regional level take into account their linkages and impacts on food security and livelihoods? This wonderful topic will be discussed by Peter Kiogluku, Director, TRAPCA Tanzania. Second left. Peter Kialuku is the executive director of TRAPCA, that is Trade Policy Training Center in Africa. Peter has been an international management consultant with specialist skills in corporate strategy and marketing. He previously managed the Global Leadership and Management Sustainability Program and was manager for marketing and business development at ISAMI. ISAMI is Eastern and Southern African Management Institute. So those are the topics which you should prepare yourselves to listen to and discuss. Without wasting much time, I will start straight away with matter to discuss what are the effects of incoherent trade and climate policies, regimes on food security and livelihoods at regional and national levels. The floor is yours, Mata Bekele.
Thank you, Ambassador. So yeah, until the PowerPoint comes. When you were reading my CV, I was wondering if you were talking about someone else. I didn't know that I had such a long CV. And look at me, I'm such a young lady. Okay, so the title of my presentation is the title is Incoherent Trade and Climate Policies or Regimes on Food Security and Livelihoods at Regional and National Levels in the EAC. But basically what I'm going to do is I'm going to present how climate change is related to trade, to food security, how trade is related to food security, how food security and climate change are related, and then I bring together all these three, but in the context of the East African community. Once we establish such a relation or interlinkages among these elements, what I'm going to present is our findings under our PACT project, where we found in each and every country in the East African community, there is incoherence of policies of these three elements. Okay, so as an introduction, I would like to describe the economies of these five countries. When you talk about East African community, you're talking about Burundi, Rwanda, Kenya, Uganda, and Tanzania. And basically, these countries are low-income countries, except Kenya, which is a lower middle-income country. In terms of population size, the least is Burundi, having only 10 million people, 10.8 million people, whereas you have Tanzania, 51.8 million people. In terms of rural population, we have the average of 69 to 88, the range, percent of people living in rural areas. This is high, this figure is high, even by the standards of sub-Saharan Africa. If you look at the sub-Saharan Africa, the rural population is 63%, whereas the world average figure is 47%. So what this shows you is that so many people of East Africans live in rural areas, and this has an implication when we talk about climate change and food security. Now, in terms of GDP, we are talking about, these are extremely low-level. In terms of economic development and income, these are countries that can be said poor. For instance, if you compare, the biggest GDP you see here is, for instance, Kenya's, which is 60.9 billion. But you compare that to South Africa, which has like 349.8 billion, whereas India's GDP is like 2.1 trillion. In terms of poverty headcount, this is people living under the poverty line, and you have as high as 69.9, that is 67% of Burundians, for instance, live below the poverty line. So now that we've described the economies of these countries, to emphasize on the importance of agriculture, the share of agriculture is high, about 24 to 35%, and the employment generated through employment opportunity generated through agriculture is about 75 to 93%. And then, of course, there is this similarity in their export items when it comes to agricultural products, majorly concentrating on black tea, coffee, and cut flowers, cashew nuts, and cigarettes. Now, state of food security, trade, and climate change in the EAC. So here, I'll just quickly describe the state of food security, trade, and climate change in the EAC. Now, when you look at food security, as you know, FAO has indicators for food insecurity or food security. You look at availability, affordability, utilization, and stability. Okay, and when you look at the scores for these five countries in the EAC, it is very low, except Uganda. Just hold on. And in terms of you look at the income, the average income spent on food, for instance, it's very high. That is also another indicator. And you have this global indicators of food security. And out of 109 countries, you have Burundi being 105th. So you can see these countries are food insecure, majority of them. Then when you look at state of trade, of course, as you would expect, the trade deficit is huge. Look at Kenya, which is the black one, the black graph chart. So as you can see, the difference between exports and imports, look at Tanzania's, which is the
yellow,
and Uganda, green, and the other small economies. Now, what would be interesting is not the having trade deficit, but their share in the world market, in the world trade. And Kenya's share in merchandise trade is only 0.03, and Kenya's share in trade in services is only 0.08. I'm mentioning Kenya because it is supposed to be the biggest economy. In terms of climate change is real for us. If there are any deniers here who believe that there is no climate change is real for us. And these are news clippings that I got from the internet. They describe about the effect of El Nino. Though I'm talking about, for instance, East African community, we are seeing the effects of climate change, for instance, in Ethiopia, where we are experiencing right now the worst drought in 30 years because of climate change. Before you came, before 3-4 weeks ago, we were losing people because of flooding here in Kenya. And that is climate change. And climate change, as I said, and I want to emphasize, it is real for us here in the region. Now, food security, climate change, and trade linkages, I would like to contextualize. Of course, there is a linkage. Trade with climate change, food security with climate change, trade, food security. But just to contextualize what we mean for the region, climate change and food security. In EAC, there is increasing, the frequency and the severity of drought, flooding, have been increasing, and this have been impacting food production. And this is exacerbated by limited irrigation practices, as well as reliance, of course, on erratic rainfall. Not only just rainfall, but erratic rainfall. So that is the context that we are giving it here in Eastern Africa, in East African community. Now, in terms of food security and trade in the EAC, of course, we have poor market infrastructure, and we have inadequate food trade within the region as a result. And if you look at food import, the size of food import out of total merchandise, you would realize that it is significant. Food, we import a lot of food here in the region. Looking at trade and climate and their relation within Eastern Africa, East African community, I beg your pardon, is that, for instance, can't read. Yeah, Like, for instance, in 1997-98, we had El Nino, and it had greatly impacted and disrupted trade within the region. As you know, Mombasa is the gateway for many of the exports coming from Mombasa, and that had really impacted, disrupted trade. And then there are areas in Tanzania, as you can see, northwest, west, and south, fertile parts of Tanzania are usually cut off when there is heavy rain. When it comes to effects of trade on climate change, as you can see in Uganda and Tanzania, in Uganda, you have this increasing production of maize and climate change. That has been impacting the environment. And then in Tanzania, of course, we have the charcoal trading. And that trade activity has been impacting climate and resulting in climate change.
3 minutes.
How many?
Three.
3 minutes, okay. So now, linking food security, trade, and climate change, how do we link it within the EAC? The EAC Food Security Action Plan itself recognizes that factors for food insecurity in the region are, number one, inadequate trade. So it is relating food security with trade and high variability of weather due to climate change. So now that we have established there is this linkage among the three elements, trade, food security, and climate change, what have we found when we went into the five countries and examined their policies? In Burundi, we realized that climate change In Burundi, climate change, trade, food security issues are handled by different institutions. So after establishing the linkages, of course, we are advocating for the linkages of these three issues and to bring policy coherence I need my slides. These are findings from countries. I have not crammed them. Unless now I start calling people from Uganda, they tell us, people from Rwanda. Okay, good. So we continue. Let's continue. Burundi. Kenya, we found duplication of efforts by so many organs, government organs and even efforts by development partners. When it comes to these issues. Then in Rwanda, what we found out is that climate change strategy is already in place, but what is lacking is implementation is not aligned to mainstreaming climate change. Adaptation and mitigation in key sectors. In Tanzania, we found there is disconnect between the country's trade policy and climate issues. So as you can see, we've proposed so many recommendations. I was just trying to summarize. Thanks. Incoherence at national and regional levels. When you look at Uganda, we found out that policies in place do not recognize the linkages, the interlinkages of the three elements. And lastly, at regional level, at the EAC Secretariat, we found out that climate change, food security, and trade policies, strategies, and action plans are all in place at the secretariat level, but they are not designed to address the interlinkages holistically. Conclusion. So what is the conclusion? Why were we pushing to establish this nexus and to bring it to the attention of policymakers? The reason is that trade, we are proposing, can be a tool, a solution to counter the effects of climate change on food insecurity through improved distribution and exchange of food, as well as access to mitigation and adaptation techniques. So we are pushing and recommending for sectoral policy coherence and coordination, as well as we're saying that such policies should be holistic. Yeah. So to learn more about the project, you can visit this link. Yeah.
Thank you very much. I will not want to summarize what she has been speaking about in order to save time. I will go straight to the next speaker. And now I have the honor to call upon John Mwesigye to talk to us on how synergized climate and trade policies regimes can enhance food security and livelihoods. 7 minutes.
Thank you, Ambassador. Good evening, everyone. I'm grateful to be here before the end of this year, 2015. I think we are here in February, trying to talk about the same topic, and now we are back to emphasize and take stock of what we have achieved so far. Because as experts and campaigners, we have to make sure that our campaign does not stop in the air. It has to achieve something. I'd also prepared a small presentation, as Ambassador has mentioned, on almost the same topic. But most of the issues about climate change have been mentioned by the previous speaker. Mine is just to bear testimony of what Rwanda did after this EAC Pact project came to Rwanda. That time I was at the Minister of Trade and Industry as a trade expert and a trade negotiator, as I mentioned in my CV. These people were actually clever because they put us on board and became members of the reference group. So you can imagine a government being put as a member of the reference group, which means whatever will be raised, you will accept because you're already part of the team. But before I go to what came out of those campaigns and consultations, I also have to talk a little about climate change. You know, it's a big issue. I don't know whether you can go to the third presentation, the slide. Continue. This one. Yeah, these are basics. We all know, but the issue is that we never talk about climate change. We just think about it, run over it, and continue. Business as usual. Mm-hmm. These are basics which we need to always remind ourselves before we can think of doing anything. I know most of us, if we can ask ourselves, have you ever done anything as far as combating climate change? The only answer you can give is that I attended a meeting. I attended a workshop in which it was discussed. Maybe myself, what I've done, you know, Rwanda has stopped the use of polythene bags. Have you heard about this? In the last 5 years, we have exchanged polythene bags for envelopes, paper bags. And it has worked. What I've done myself as far as combating this is concerned, every final week of the month, we plant trees and we do general cleaning in my country. So I'm proud that I've at least I've done something as far as combating climate change is concerned. And those of you who have been to Kigali in the last 1 month, I think it's the greenest city either in Africa or the seventh in the world. That report has come out. So if I ask you, have you done anything to combat climate change?
Yes.
Can you say anything? Or probably most of us can say I've attended the workshop. Anyway, let me use my 7 minutes. You see the causes that we, most of us are producing to export, to forgetting that we even need to save some food for our families. You know that in most of our families, if you grow bananas, the best banana will go to the market and we will eat the small one. The big one will go to the market so that we get money out of the big banana. If I'm lying, effects, you see our forests are almost finished, flooding everywhere, a low crop yields, droughts, as she was saying, changing biodiversity, spread of diseases. Yeah, then control measures, we are trying to use soil erosion methods, intensify agriculture to increase our food security. We are also trying to change technology to... Yeah, what is our responsibility? Our responsibility could be, first of all, probably implementing the international agreements to which we are party. Issues of reduction in emissions, support national platforms, look at our policies. How do we make policies? Do we consider these climate change issues and food security? What decisions do we make? How are we doing the trade? Are we trading? Are we moving food from the areas of high yields to low areas, or we only take the food to the market where we can get cash? Now let me try to rush at what we achieved as Rwanda after this EAC Pact project came to. At that time, I was at the Ministry of Trade. We actually took the commitment. We took the commitment. It's on slide five. These people came to our ministry. First of all, they put us in the National Reference Group. They held workshops, we were invited. We held breakfast meetings. They organized the workshop with the National Trade Policy Forum to convince us. Actually, it was not convincing us, just to remind us that our policies do not take into account climate change issues, food security. Our National Trade Policy document was only looking at a few things like increasing our exports, more production, more trade, but it was not considering. Among the cross-cutting issues of that policy document, there was a small paragraph on environment. It was talking about preserving the environment so that we can increase production, since most of Rwanda's exports are agricultural exports. So we took commitment as government. It appreciated the campaign. It was timely. Also agreed to include the civil society platform and other civil society organizations on the National Trade Policy Forum so that they can be consulted whenever there is a policy being drafted, so that their ideas can be included. The ministry expressed commitment to because we are revising a trade policy document at that time. So the government was committed to put a kind of chapter or an article in the new document. At the moment,
I'm afraid I have to cut you short. Please try to conclude.
Okay, 1 minute.
Please.
I just want to tell you what we achieved. Actually, the document itself, the trade policy document, was not revised. There came a new idea that East African community wanted to develop a regional trade policy document. So what Rwanda did, they shifted our ideas to a study being conducted to draft the EAC document. So all our ideas related to all cross-cutting issues, environment, climate change, food security, vulnerable groups, were put in the new study going on at the EAC level. And we hope that everything will be reflected in the EAC document. Thanks a lot, Ambassador.
Thank you very much. I want to beg indulgence of the speakers. I'm sorry I have to hurry you to conclude. That's the time which you have been allocated, and try to frame your talk in such a way that you fit within the time you are given. I have the honor now to call upon the next speaker, that is Paul Murage, who is speaking on the same subject.
Good evening this evening. Yeah, first of all, may I welcome you in Kenya, because for this session, I am a Kenyan. And what I'm going to present here is the impact. We have heard from the past speakers talking about the issue of climate change. But packaging that information has been the challenge. So CARTS International, for those who don't know what the abbreviation means, Consumer United Trade Society, came to Kenya, Consumer United Trade Society. They came to Kenya, and we were very much privileged that we were able to carry out research in two counties of Kenya, Muranga and Makueni. So the impact of that research, next slide please. So the mandate of any meteorological service worldwide is provision of weather and climate information for safety of life and property. But there has been a challenge in packaging that information. Each time we are having El Nino, the symposium could not have been held at a better time like this one, where you are looking at what is the impact of climate change, of extreme weather on livelihoods, agriculture, and then trade. Any meteorological service will be geared. It is responsibility to observe weather, that is carry out weather observation, to do modeling and forecasting. But we want to appreciate and we want to partner with other social scientists. We want to change the perception. Our African countries, more so in the East African community, where we are located at the equator, they are doubting so much about weather forecasting. For your information, when we issued our forecast here in Kenya, everybody was saying these guys just want to eat some money. When El Nino arrived, they asked, where is the El Nino money? Right now, we had a dry spell of around 5 days, but everybody had already said El Nino is not there. So we need now, how do we package that information? Because that is where the interventions of CARTS and Kenya Meteorological Department came in. We need to partner with the media so that even when they are packaging the weather information, they don't cause alarm. This particular session, or this particular session, I have not heard any journalist talk about the opportunities that come with enhanced rainfall, like rainwater harvesting. Everybody is talking about death. And we are looking at a country where, in some counties like Narok, for example, I give an example, within 6 months you can have drought. And the next month you have, within another 6 months, they have flooding. April, we lost 10 people in the same county due to flooding. But we are looking at having, partnering with you, economic scientists, to tell the other sectors what is the economic impact of ignoring weather and climate information. Because that is what we want to put. So, in our intervention, we were able to look mother and my other presenters have talked about the disconnect between climate change, agriculture, and trade. We were able, next slide, please. We were able in Muranga to bring the three players together. From where you are seated, you can see the executive minister, that is the minister for agriculture in Muranga County, who was able now to articulate which issues will the county government of Muranga do. That other person addressing me is the county director for those who are Kenyans, for Nyeri, Francis Guata, who was weather presenter. We had invited him to come and now demystify this weather jargon, because one of the accusations has, we have been talking to ourselves. In the local language, when you tell somebody the probability of having rain for more than 40%, they want the figures. So we have decentralized our services. So how did we arrive at this one? We need gender representation. We were able, Muranga County has, in the new dispensation, Kenya has 47 counties. Muranga has 8 sub-counties. We selected 3 farmers, one who was already. Each county, each sub-county. So we had allowed 12 women who are represented, because women are the ones who are more impacted by the effects of climate change. Because in the counties that we are having, women are the ones who go to the farm. Women are the ones who are hooking the produce. So if we, and if I were to quote the President Barack Obama when he came here, he said, when you are playing without women, you are playing with half the team. So we were able now to look what is the role of women. Next one, I can say. So we were able even to look at how women are doing that. This is one lady, is a former, I can see him seated, the programs officer of CATS International. We were able even to go to the field. Now, all those results, because we had 152 people, what did we wanted to reach the maximum number of people with this information on how they are related. How we did it, next slide. In Muranga, we are very much pleased that we Kenya Meteorological Department, together with the community, lands a radio station. We call them Lanet Station, which communicates in local language. So the county director, who happened to be around this room, we hosted a climate scientist to demystify to the community what is this climate change we are talking about. So we were able to reach our listeners. Also, we also partnered with Radio Maria, which is a Catholic land radio. Why are we deciding to go on radio? Let's go to the next slide. In Kenya, most people listen to the radio. And they also go even to their farms, even in their public service vehicle. So if rather than printing, you have to look how many of us are on Skype, maybe all of you in this room, but how many are on Skype in the Lulo setup? Maybe even not in the MIBA of the county are separate. So what we are looking at, we realize that this is the radio we want to pass the message. But now we have the challenge of the radio, because it's expensive to host a program on radio. So we went to the county government of Muranga, because the community radio has that kilometer radius. Next, we go next step. The county government of Muranga has to enhance that signal so that it will cover, for that circular radius you are seeing, it will be able to cover the whole of Muranga, communicating in the Kikuyu language, such that you can tell the farmers when to plant and who want to do other interventions next. Following that, His Excellency the Governor of Muranga also gazetted a task force on climate change, where we are looking all those ones at the terms of reference, ensuring sustainable agricultural development. We are looking at sustainability. We want our citizens to change in the East Africa community, doing agriculture just as a culture. We want them to do it as a business, angry business, so that they'll be able to fend for themselves. Then secure food security and stability of food supply and improved marketing of products. Next step. Now, in conclusion, we want now, we are urging and we are requesting, as I equipped in my first slide, the role of social scientists in packaging the weather information, the packaging, the leaders, we were able to bring the leaders together. But we are looking, that is one county, but we want nationally, and this is the intervention that we are looking at, the part that you can play. We want to partner with you. We look at how can we see the enterprises affected. Chair, thank you very much. As I look at it, the effect of extreme weather can lead to the infrastructure damage, such that the produce will not reach the market. And even if now, so that will mean loss. And that's why some farmers are doing away with farming, because when they have a bumper harvest, there is poor prices. But then the other extreme, they are also losing. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Paul, for your presentation. My only problem is time management. I don't know what I can do, really. But I hope the remaining two will help me to manage time on my behalf. Each is going to speak for 7 minutes. And the next speaker I'm calling happened to speak on are UNFCCC and WTO regimes acting in synergy to each other and taking into account of the food security and livelihood concerns. And the speaker is Ms. Jane Nalunga. 7 minutes. When I say 3 minutes, that means you are supposed to be thinking of concluding.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Chair. And good afternoon, comrades. My topic is UNFCCC and the WTO regime. Are they acting in synergy for food security and livelihood concerns of LDCs? I'll look at the linkages. I'll look at the Paris outcome. I'll look at the issues at MC10 here, and also look at the synergies there, the implication and way forward. As you all know, climate change is one of the defining issues of our times. It affects food security, it affects agriculture, it affects trade, and it affects people's livelihoods. And in fact, our survival in Africa is on the exploitation of natural resources like agriculture, forestry, fisheries, and these are areas, sectors which are affected by climate change. And as you know, the poorer people are, the nearer they are to nature. So climate change is very, very important. I won't overflow the linkages, but when we trade is about economic growth and industries and emissions, and this is affecting green gas emissions and climate change. But again, trade can be an avenue to get technology which we can use for mitigation and adaptation. So there are positive and negative synergies between trade and climate change. But the question is, can or has the UNFCCC meeting in Paris and the MC10 here, are they going to work in synergy to be able to address issues of food security and livelihood? Let me start with the UNFCCC outcomes. As you are aware, the UNFCCC, its major purpose is to stabilize the emissions at levels that are not dangerous to climate disruption. That's its major purpose. But when you look at the Paris outcome, it's so mixed. It's almost like somebody looking at an elephant, you know, touching an elephant, you touch an ear, you say, oh, it's soft. You touch a tail, it's small, you know, because some people have summed up the Paris outcome as that the operation was a success, but the patient died. In other words, the outcomes were not very good. But let us look at the outcomes in Paris. It was agreed that 2 degrees, 2C was the maximum acceptable global temperatures, and that countries should pursue efforts to limit their temperatures at 1.5 degrees. But this, if countries are to do this, we have to have a binding agreement on emissions, which wasn't agreed upon. What was agreed upon in Paris, that each country should strive towards cutting emissions. There was no binding agreement. Another issue which is related to agriculture and livelihoods is the issue of financing, additional financing for adaptation and mitigation. This one wasn't also addressed. Another issue again was about technology transfer. Developing countries, poor countries need technology transfer for them to be able to migrate to clean technology. This wasn't addressed because, again, technology transfer was left under intellectual property and as a private property. So when you look at the outcomes of the Paris UNFCC, they won't be able to address issues of agriculture, food security, and livelihoods. When you look at the WTO here, the big animal, elephant in the room, are subsidies. You know, the developed countries' subsidies on the issues of agriculture and the implication. In fact, when you look at the issue of agriculture, the way it has been handled here, there's a lot of room for improvement. The issue of subsidies hasn't been addressed. The issue of a safeguard mechanism, a usable special safeguard mechanism, hasn't been addressed. The issue of cotton hasn't been addressed. Cotton is important. If farmers are not getting an income from what they are producing, they will leave the villages and they won't produce food. There is also the issue of environmental goods, negotiations on environmental goods. That also is an issue which has been put on the back burner. So when you look at generally what has been agreed on in the MC10, how negotiations are going on, you can see the issue of food security hasn't been agreed upon, and also the issue of environment hasn't been addressed. So the issue of climate change also hasn't been addressed. So the question, my question was, are these two working in synergy? Yes, they are working in synergy, but not to address food security and livelihoods. It's to promote corporate interests. How do we reorient the WTO here to work for the people, to work for agriculture, to work for livelihoods? And how do we orient the UNFCC again to work for food security and people's livelihoods? Thank you, Chair.
Thank you very much for the presentation. Next, I call upon Kialuku to speak on the climate and trade policies. That's the same topic. The climate and trade policies at regional level take into account their linkages and impact on food security and livelihoods. The floor is yours, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much, Session Chair. My work has been made a bit easier because the context upon which this presentation is based is the initial research work that was done as part of the project. And what Martha initially presented, although in a hurried manner because of the time constraints, was the country studies that provided case studies for the trainers to be able to customize training intervention to build capacity for the stakeholders in the five EAC countries including the East African Secretariat. And therefore, my work is very simple. I'm pulling all those threads together to show exactly then what happened as a result of the capacity building intervention. We had very diverse participant mix from the five countries, including the EAC Secretariat, which included NGOs, government officials, and policy think tanks and researchers from the five countries. We then look at just the typical theory of change in terms of the training interventions, and then we've just plotted these on the basis of the inputs, the activities, the outputs, the outcomes, and the impacts. Now, I'm not sure whether this is very readable from where you are, but I'll basically just go very quickly over it because it's basically my main part of the presentation. And we had the inputs which were part of the key stakeholders and the research that provided the basis for doing the training materials and the case studies for the participants. Then we did training activities on the basis of the research that was done and conducted 10 national training events and 3 regional training events. But in between, we also did some follow-up, and the outputs of these were quite a number of participants who went through these training in all the countries and in very diverse sectors. And as a result of this, we had officials who could be able to articulate policies better and try to do the connections between the climate change, food security, and trade. And then on the basis of those competencies, then several campaigns were carried out, and the impacts, many of which have already been presented, like the information to farmers or effective participation to negotiators, policies that were drafted. And from our own evaluation of the training events, which was based on feedback from the participants, we can confidently say then that in terms of that theory of change, we feel the training positively impacted on the participants. But still this, I think I want to conclude by saying it had some challenges. The first challenge was the complexity of the issues and the connections that trainers are able to make on what appeared to be initially 3 disparate topics. And we had to go through these with a lot of help from experts to make sure that the training materials were at the level of the participants, who were again also a very mixed group. Initially, there was also a weak existing knowledge base. And again, these had also to be overcome largely by having the national partners of CATS, who were extremely competent and managed to get the national teams together and carried out also sensitization before the training. And the last one, which was actually the biggest challenge, was the inadequacy of relevant training materials that are ready to use for each country. Although these are countries within the same region, we definitely found out each had its own unique challenges in terms of the connections for the 3 topics that were to be covered. And the major work that was carried out by the trainers was the first development of draft training materials, piloting those materials before carrying out the training events. We still, as way forward, feel there is a scope to scale up this, on the basis of the success that has been achieved. I wish to thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, Peter. I want to thank the able speakers who are with me here for covering the topics given to them, despite the shortage of time, but they were able to at least give you the main element in each of the topic given to them to pass on to you. At this juncture, as I said, we are going to discuss these topics together. The panelists, the able panelists, have presented their views to you. So now it is a Q&A session. I don't know what the management would want me to give each speaker on the floor, but if it is on my own, I will decide only 2 minutes for each person to intervene from the floor. And of course, if I forgot to look at my watch, you may cheat me and go 3 minutes. But 2 minutes is what I'm going to give each one of you who will speak. And the number of speakers probably I will also reduce to about 7, slightly more than the speakers here. I will accept 8 questions or comments from the floor. I start with this gentleman here, because I saw his hand up first, I think. And then it will be followed by this lady next to him. And the other lady at the back, that one, yeah, you will be third. And this gentleman, fourth. So you get your number when you, and then the other one at the back there again. Yeah, that gentleman. That is what, fifth, then sixth, and then this one, 7. Where is the 8th one? Oh, your hands were not up. Okay, 8. So those are the 8. So number 1, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much.
2 minutes. I will now glue my eyes.
George is my name, and it happened one time to be chosen by cats, and I went to Rwanda. When I came back, I don't want to go back. What is the repercussion in my area? I had to shout a lot on the radios, and I managed to change the system in NADS, whereby we started planting trees, and the mangrove trees were the fruit trees. Thanks to Naro also came in as government agent. They taught us how to make contour ridges. We are doing it in groups. On top of that, we have got green charcoal project. 4 years, it is providing trees. It started with a few trees whereby people were not willing to take. I came in, I took, so that they may have that ability to increase more. This year, they gave us something like 400 trees, but eucalyptus. I planted 200 trees. Again, that is one way of stimulating, but people are refusing because of land grabbing. People are not aware of it. And also, thanks to CRTN, food security, it has made my district to have an ordinance. And in that ordinance, whereby farmers, we are making a group, sort of granaries, and NAR also came in. It gave me a cocoon that can keep something like 20 tons, whereby I'm also doing it for others to see. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I was going to give you 30 seconds. So number 2, please, Madam.
Hello, good evening. My name is Emily Kennedy. I'm with the Food Rights Alliance in Uganda. And my time there is being spent looking at cross-generational knowledge transfer in relation to food and water security. And I've noticed that there's an obvious trend happening in lack of involvement or perhaps interest of youth in agriculture, and even on a global scale, because I'm noticing that in my home country of Canada. So I'm just wondering how you see that impacting trade and food, food security, particularly as climate change will be making that sector much more challenging.
Thank you. Number three.
Hello. Fanfares from the Embassy of Sweden in Addis. Two very brief questions. First, indeed, it's very relevant to sort of underline and then try to convince on the link between food security, environment, and trade. But I would find it hard if there is anyone who'd challenge the link between these three thematic areas. Perhaps what would be more important and more challenging both from a thinking process point of view as well as from a practical point of view is how these three areas are being implemented in coherence at different levels. And in the presentations made this afternoon, I felt the sort of the implementation side is a bit lacking. So for instance, if there are success stories where in specific countries, be it in the EAC or somewhere else, where a sort of a trade policy or an environment policy which effectively mainstream all the three different areas and thereby manage to effectively promote livelihood is there. So that kind of a hands-on story where these areas are effectively mainstreamed in practice would be interesting for me to hear. And the second, in all the presentation, what I found it interesting is in all the presentations made, no one really mentioned the concept of resilience, and it's that one concept which is actually sort of gaining momentum, like in terms of programming and implementation. So for
25
me,
25 seconds.
Yes, for me it would be interesting to hear your reflection of the sort of the emerging concept of resilience, how different would that concept be as compared to what you're doing in these three different areas? Would it really add a value, or do you think there is a space where you can sort of invite the concept of resilience in what you do? So that kind of thinking process around there.
Thank you very much. I give you five seconds for introduction. You did introduce yourself. Did you? Okay. So number four? Yes. Number four, please.
Vipul Chatterjee of Cuts International. I'm number four. Anyway, thank you, Chair. And thank you, speakers, for your presentations. Essentially, the issue is that the food security situation in East African countries is not very good, which is evident from your presentation. And there are two issues here. One is food availability, and the second is distribution, access to food. I'm not going to speak about the second one because that's the issue of governance, food governance in particular. Now, on availability, I think it is evident that the demand is much more than supply as we speak. Therefore, in order to bridge that gap, and that demand-supply gap is also A, increasing, and B, becoming more unstable as a result of climate change impacts. And also, there are livelihood issues in case of climate change impacts on non-food crops. So what I would like to know from the speakers is how much food, staple food in particular, that these countries are importing from outside their country, from within the region, from outside the region, and what is, in order to bridge that gap, and what are import tariffs on those items?
15 seconds.
Is there going to be any change in the policy regime, on the import tariff regime particularly? And is there any case for having a regional food security policy as against national food security policies in these countries? Yes, regional policy for East Africa.
Thank you very much. Number five.
Mr. Chair, my number was grabbed. And I wish to grab.
No, but I thought
I was number three.
Yeah, you speak, please. Go ahead.
Thank you so much, Chair. Chair, my name is...
You were born lucky.
Indeed. My name is Agnes Kirabo. I happen to coordinate an alliance here on the right to food in Uganda. And I wish to make a comment. I think, Jen, you said, yes, there is synergy. And indeed, there is synergy between the Paris conclusions and what the negotiations here in WTO, because what is driving both of them is trade. Comrades, here, we need to know that climate change, whereas this side of the world, we are looking at it as a challenge. The other side of the world, climate change is an opportunity for trade, but also for food security. And I think I'm in the right platform. The issue of biomodification started in here in 1999, and it is looked at as an alternative or an option to curb climate change and then go into food security. But this is not free technology. It is traded technology, it is negotiated technology, and you see the whole of flux around the IP in the WTO. So indeed, there is the invisible synergy, and it is there. And that invisible spirit is going to continue driving the agenda in IFCC, but also in WTO. So whereas we are looking at food security and crying for it as a social good, in the nexus of trade, climate change, and food security, climate change becomes a great opportunity for people to trade, and trade what? Food or food-related items in the disguise of addressing food security. So I think we can, those of us who wish to think like I do, then we can choose our point of departure and the point of negotiations. Thank you so much, Chair.
Yeah, thank you. I will call you number G. So now number five. Some gentleman there behind. Number five.
Yeah, my name is Mustafa Otieno. My question goes to Jen on the issue of subsidies on agricultural produce. The developed countries have been subsidizing their agricultural producers, therefore making the world markets prices go low. I want us to change the perspective. The developed countries will not change the subsidies issue. Why it's the developing countries to subsidize on their agricultural produce rather than complaining to the developed countries to stop subsidizing their produce. So I think Africans and the other developing countries, we need to change our perspective and focus more on production. We have the land, we have the resources, we need to focus more on production so that when we go on the table to negotiate and to for negotiation, that we can bring more of the issues. But for now, I think we're not bringing enough on the table, so we cannot complain that these countries should reduce their subsidies. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Number six.
Yeah, here I am.
Before you.
Yeah. Okay. My name is Joseph Haemba, just from Kenya. I'll exempt my questions from the first speaker and the last speaker, because one was winding up while the other one was opening. But the three, I want to talk about something. Okay, I'll start with, okay, the 2 minutes, I'll content myself. Okay, I'll begin with the first speaker. She said something about the Uganda food security. And this one now, I wanted to direct it to Madam Jen to talk about something. You know, now that you are just neighboring to Kenya, with the tail of your eye, you always see the economic situation in Kenya. If you are given the docket in Kenya, the same docket, where would you begin from to correct the food crisis? I'm assuming that Kenya has a food crisis here and there. Where would you begin from? Or how did you begin and how do you achieve the current status as far as food security is concerned? Two, I'll look at John. I'm assuming that you came by road, right all the way from Rwanda. and you've traveled through Kenya. You've seen a lot. Now that you appear to be a hands-on kind of officer, where would you begin from if you are told to remain in Kenya and try to contain the climate change? Where would you begin from? What is it that's rotting in Kenya? Because we want to hear something from you. Then I wanted to look at my fellow Kenyan, that is Paul.
Just 15 seconds.
Correct, I'm okay. Paul, you talked good about Muranga or wherever. That was a very narrow perspective. Now, your point of communication or medium of communication was one language and a few other aspects. If you are given the whole country, you are told not to go back to Muranga now, you remain here, what will you do? Then.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm just finishing. One. Just okay, finally, to all of you.
So, thank you.
Just one more.
No,
I'm on the floor. Please, I'm on the floor. Much. I'm number 7 on the floor. My
yes.
Name is George Mungau Okonji from the Civil Society. Now, mine will be very brief. I'll just add value to what our lady down there spoke about the food security. We can't be comfortable talking about the food security without talking about food safety and food quality. Now, to all panelists, what will it be your take on GMO foods, GMO, because some Monsanto, if I may mention, they are creating the GMOs and taking advantage, that we have been told, in the sense of trade, to give us food that's not fit for our consumption. I want you to tell us about GMO foods, your take on GMO foods. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And last but not least, eight. Who's number 8? Yes, please.
Yes, thank you very much. I'm Francis. My question go to my friend from Ranga. In fact, the guy has just touched my question. One thing I wanted, I really conquer with you. I'm also from civil society. I wanted just to know the plan you have for the other counties, because we know Nini, climate change is a cross-cutting issue, and it's very serious. And one thing I know in this country, around 40% of Kenyans, they don't know the meaning of climate change. Only Nairobians know climate change. We are talking here.
Thank you very much. You can see that I think these panelists ably covered the subject and aroused in you a lot of interest, because if they did not do so, you would not be asking so many questions. And I have to stop some of you from asking questions. I'm very sorry for that. I will now give the chance to the panelists to answer. I will start from my right, starting with John, to answer or to give what he thinks he can answer. If there's nothing, you pass on, like the button.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I think I have one question to answer, but I will also contribute to other questions later. And the only thing I can tell this gentleman is that,
3 minutes,
okay. Yes, is that in Kigali, we don't have the business of shoe polish. So if you want to invest in shoe polish in Kigali, you will not make business, because our roads are clean, right from the main roads, the highways, the locations. So you can look around a kilometer and you don't get a shop where you can buy shoe polish, because it has no business there. So if I was brought to Kenya to look at roads, I'm actually sleeping at Monarch Hotel up there. So this morning it rained, and I've polished my shoe 3 times today. So if I'm given the docket
to work on roads, probably I may not know where to start from. Because I may not construct roads immediately, maybe I can first convince Kenyans to love their infrastructure, the infrastructure. Because if you construct a road, probably in a week or a month, it will have been destroyed. Where I can start from is to convince Kenyans that please love your infrastructure because it costs a lot of money. Yeah.
Thank you very much, John. Now I call upon Jen to. There were some specific questions.
Thank you so much for those comments. 3 minutes. I will start with a GMO food. GMO, I'm very passionate about that. In Africa, I think we need to talk about food sovereignty. And food sovereignty starts with seed sovereignty, the right to seed. If you don't have the right to seed, you can't talk about the right to food. My brother, Kenya food security, what would I do? We could mainstream the food market, the food trade between Kenya and Uganda. It has so many challenges. Because, for example, we produce a lot of maize. Kenya has a deficit in maize. But what's happening, Kenyan traders go directly to the farmers deep in the village, buy very little money. They don't care about the standards. And, you know, so I would mainstream the maize trade and also the other food trade and work on your food security issue. Because Kenya, you have a food security problem. Uganda, we don't have. My brother Mustafa, I admire your patriotism. The whole issue about subsidies, it isn't that we care so much whether Europe and US are giving subsidies, but we care because of the implication on our economy, on our agriculture. When they give subsidies, those things end up on our market. Go to your shops. Most of the cheese, everything, the milk is from outside. And that discourages production, and that affects production, affects agriculture, affects food security. One minister was telling us, our minister of trade, he comes from 500 kilometers from our capital, but he was telling us in his small town, peanut butter from the US is cheaper than the peanut butter they produce locally. That's why subsidies are very, very important. Okay, I'll stop there. The others can handle.
Thank you very much. I go now to Marta to answer some questions directed to her. You start with what is directed to you first before you venture into the general one.
Thank you, Chair. Maybe before I react to the speakers, I mean to the floor, I just want to remind Jane that when you say Uganda is not food insecure, that's not what the figures are showing us, because as I presented, don't forget Karamoja. Okay. Okay. Corrected. Okay.
Can you direct?
Sure. Let me talk about the main point here. The main point about linking these three elements, and Fantu was saying that the linkages are obvious. And I would like to challenge you. The obvious is the most ignored, usually. CATS happens to be the first organization to bring the trade element and proposing trade as a solution to food insecurity in relation to climate change. You asked about implementation and what have we achieved. I wish you were here in September, here in Hilton, actually. This room, actually.
So the government of Rwanda, the government of Uganda, the government of Tanzania, Burundi, Rwanda, they were all present here. And they were telling us the impact that our project had. I'll just give you two examples. For instance, in Tanzania, they tried and actually to bring policy change when it comes to charcoal trading, because it is directly related to climate change and food security. In Kenya, when they were drafting the environment policy, they have totally ignored trade aspects. And it is because of us urging them and them being part of our reference group that came about. Residents, definitely, we're talking about climate resilience, crops, and we're trying to bring that element actually. We are now moving from pure agriculture and relating these elements. Now we are trying to bring in the agro-processing aspect of it. Yes, I should stop here.
Thank you. Next, Peter.
Okay. Thank you, Chair. Nothing really specific came to me, but I want to answer something that is general. The first observation is, for whatever reason, CATS decided to draft me into this, because I do realize there is very heavy TRAPCA representation on this panel. But it also goes to show the power of empowerment, the power of capacity building, and a lot of the issues that people asked here. I think if we do more capacity building programs and relevant training, that's basically, I think, what we'll get ourselves out of the problems that we seem to have, the challenges that we seem to have. I feel that is really where the key issue lies. So let's do and engage in relevant capacity building programs. You can negotiate, you can have contracts, you can have anything that you want, but a lot of these documents are going to be on shelves, on desks. I don't think a lot of the challenges and issues we have is for lack of documents showing us what to do. It's basically a challenge of implementation. People don't have the capacity to move from theory to practice or to policy to practice. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Peter. So last but not least.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're with your 3 minutes.
Yeah, there are two. Well, if I were first to start with Mr. Emba. As I was presenting, I said that in September 2012, the Kenya Meteorological Department decentralized its services to the counties, where each county has a county director of meteorology. But what's happened is that you take the national focus and it's downscaled to each county. So each county has the focus, and that's where now you get the advisory from. The issue of language, we realize, is the packaging of weather information that has been the challenge. Because for this scientific jargon, below normal, above normal, hierarchies of Rift Valley, that has been the jargon. We want to communicate in locally understood language, such the farmer will know what is the time for planting, which is the projected the distribution, and also what are the interventions. We want to communicate that in locally understood language. There is a lady who asked from Ethiopia who asked about resilience. When you trace weather and climate information, the essence is we want to look at the value chain, the whole value chain of production. Because we are having a lot of losses, right from germination up to post-harvest. Because we are having a country where we are having a bumper harvest, but we are losing it because of handling. So that's why Mother is talking about issues of agro-processing. Because we are having a bumper harvest. When you have a bumper harvest, can we turn it to powdered milk and then you trace it later? So the essence here is about the issue of you tracing with the information. The issue, Mike, there is from the civil society also asked about the GMO. This is a topic which the government of Kenya, for example, is so passionate. It's an open discussion. But I also want to quip a question to all of you. You are looking at a hungry person. Will you look whether it's GMO, will you eat fast so that you survive? So we must first, even when we are talking about climate change, drought escaping crops, not resistant. There is no crop that you can put it. So the issue of GMO has to be looked at holistically, not just one side or the other side. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, able panelists, for giving very competent answers to the questions given. A few issues. The issue of WTO and UNFCC, I think the two are now beginning to converge and ensuring that they work on the climate so that it ensures trade, proper trade, without destroying the nature. That's why in WTO we now have a committee on trade and environment. So that my friend here talked about charcoal. In some parts of the East African area, you find the trees are being cut down and causing a bit of problem. Then the question of subsidies, I think there was a question on that. Subsidies, the effect is that we in Africa are importing a lot more than we would have done if the subsidies were not there. Because these countries like America, like Europe, they're subsidizing their farmers. They make their food production cheaper than in Africa. Outside Africa, for example, there is a place called Haiti, where I know because of food subsidy, farmers there are no longer producing anything. Everything is coming from America. They have to buy from there. So food subsidy, the effect is it affects the production in the country, and then you will be dependent on outside food. Even in WTO, we are discussing this question of subsidy because we want them to remove so that the food prices can be equal in the market. Then there is this issue of climate change and trade. Of course, he touched on it, and Paul also touched on it. Now, if, for example, right now, El Nino is, I think, I'm told this El Nino now in Nairobi, and I was conversing with a driver who was taking me to the conference center, and they said, rice now is ripe in many fields, but the rain is spoiling rice. And if you had grown rice for commercial purposes, you are likely to lose in trade. So those are some of the... Then we have... I think food import. Subsidies as well as food import is more or less the same. Subsidies make Africa import more food, and food import to Africa, as I said, is a great deal. We don't have statistic figures, but I'm sure somebody who spoke about food security or insecurity could provide some figure for you how much we are importing, even in Kenya only. How much rice, for example, or how much, you know, importing in this country because of the effect of the climate alone, destroying foods in the fields so that you are not able to harvest the quantity you would have expected to have cultivated. I thank you very much for full participation in this brief workshop. I don't know why I call it workshop or meeting. Some of the topics covered here, you remember in September last year, we talked about them. And in fact, to some of you who were here, I think it was a repetition of what you were told. I was expecting my friend from Moranga to tell us about the early warning system also. But of course, that was not the area for discussion today. So thank you very much. Now I want to call the management, the organizers, if there's anything to say before I close the meeting.
Thank you, Ambassador. I'm just taking the mic for 2 seconds to thank you very much, to thank our panelists for their time and expertise, and for our participants for your very involved presence. And let's give a big hand of applause to our chair and panelists.